HarperCollins presents Field Notes from a Waterborne Land, Bengal Beyond the Bhadralok, written by Parimal Bhattacharya, read by Anindya Chakravorty. A note for listeners before we begin. Don't forget to download the enhanced PDF containing supporting material for this title from your audiobook provider. If we look into our hearts, we will have to admit that the India we know is actually the India of the Bhadralok. Rabindranath Tagore. There is no lie that does not have at its core some truth. Only one must know how to listen. J.M. Coetzee, Age of Iron. Note from the author. It began with the mystery of the invisible children. I read in a newspaper report that 8 out of 10 children who enrolled in West Bengal's primary schools dropped out before they completed secondary education. Where did they go? The statistical handbook of the state from which the report had quoted could not give a clue. But 8 out of 10 was a big number, nearly 20 times more than the official number of child labourers in the state. Where were they, if not in schools? I couldn't remember noticing many out-of-school children, except in the dingy crevices of my city, in squatter settlements and around railway stations. I fished around for some time until I sensed that this required a formal approach. I applied for and received a grant from the University Grants Commission, UGC, for a research project. This gave me a passport to go to places not on tourist maps, visit institutions, and interview people. This was in 2006. The Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, the program for universal primary education, was in its sixth year. I planned to complete the project in 2 years. But I had more on my hands than I had imagined. Soon after I began my travels and talked to people, I discovered that universal primary education is a prism. It refracts a spectrum of economic, social, cultural, and even ecological issues which usually remain muddled. Thus, what began as a straightforward inquiry grew into a labyrinth. My curiosity hardened into an obsession. I lost my tree in the forest. After 2 years, I was still making trips to out-of-way places in South Bengal and also in eastern Odisha. I couldn't complete the project and returned the grant to the UGC. But what I think I learned during that time was how to listen to stories, extraordinary stories told by seemingly ordinary people about themselves and about the land on which they lived. Delta Bengal is a young landmass built by silt-carrying rivers, a waterborne land, which is still being made and unmade. Its fertility and accessibility through its rivers and the sea have always drawn people. Agriculturists, artisans, merchants, freebooters and colonizers, making it one of the most prosperous and historically significant regions in the subcontinent. However, all that is in the past. The majority of the people who now live on the ruins of a once highly commercialized land are either tied to subsistence farming or are transiting all over the country to work in its informal sectors. Battered by cyclones, floods, and the rough hand of history, partition, their story is one of untold misery, but also of remarkable grit. How different these stories are from the one we have been telling each other and the world. The story of a lazy, argumentative, culture-loving community who loved their adda, Mishti Doyen Tagore. This, I realized, is the story of my kind of people. A small segment of the more than 9 crore who originate from the Indian side of the Bengal Delta and speak Bangla, the educated urban middle class and mostly upper caste Hindus, the Bhadralok. The realization made me undertake the most difficult of journeys to my own space, my roots, without the blinkers of self-delusion. When I began these journeys, the Left Front was still in power in West Bengal. But the formidable Red Bastion was being hollowed out, particularly in rural areas. It soon crumbled, sooner than anyone had expected. The well-oiled machine of a party society gave way to disorder and improvisation. But this also pulled down old walls for the winds of change to blow. Since then, several state welfare schemes targeted at young people and students, particularly girl students, have shown positive results. But as elsewhere in the country, the shift towards privatization of education has accelerated. Many state-run schools in urban areas have closed down for lack of students. Some of the descendants of the early settlers, those gritty men and women who built a life from scratch, have become dependent on government programs. With the returns from farming dwindling, the labor migration has continued. As I write these lines, nearly 2 years of a pandemic and lockdown have pushed this population to the brink. The schools are closed, and an uncountable number of children have dropped out. Meanwhile, the climate crisis has worsened. 4 major cyclones have ravaged coastal Bengal in about 2 years, turning swaths of land practically uninhabitable. But people still hang on, bracing themselves for the quirks of nature and the state, for the next cyclone or the Citizenship Act, because they have nowhere else to go. I've tried to tell their stories, stories rooted in their locales. I've changed the names of people, primary locations, and institutions throughout the book. Names of organizations like Astika Agro and Miserio are fictitious. In some cases, I fashioned a character out of more than one real person, bending the factual to be truthful. Thus, Amitabh, Radha Rokeya, Gauranguda, Bishu, the Shens, the Guptos, and many others exist only on the pages of this book. This also applies to places like Ichhaipur, Sheshergram, Adibashipara, Dumurdi, and a few others. 2 of the hamlets I visited have since been washed away. In our waterborne land, this is in the natural order of things. What remain constant here are just some concepts. An imaginary line or a center of power, the border or the party. Always in uppercase. I made the trips at different times for over a decade, by boat, bus, train, toddy palm canoe, vano, motorized tricycle, and a motorcycle on whose rear view mirror was printed, "Objects in the mirror are closer than they appear." In the end, all that has remained with me are some objects, words and images, a glint in the eye, and the murmur of a sigh, which got closer and closer until they seeped within me and began to whisper with each other in the recesses of my memory. Chapter 1. Ganga, Ichhamati, Damodar. 16 Biddalankar Road. "I want to go home," said Ma, my mother. She had pancreatic cancer, stage 4. By home she meant our ancestral house in Gauripur, a small town 40 kilometers from Kolkata, by the river Hooghly. She had spent 3/4 of her life there. "I want to go home, take me home," Ma insisted, a new childlike obstinacy cracking her voice. We, her children and in-laws, debated the merit of her demand until we all agreed that she had a point. Ma had the right to spend her last few days in this world at a place she could claim as her own in the teeth of time. Nobody should snatch it from her. So we shifted her from the aseptic blue hospital to our old house at 16 Biddalankar Road. We set up a critical care facility there, as far as practicable, and got in touch with an agency for round-the-clock attendant service. They sent us two women who divided the day between them. Bharati Das worked the day shifts. In her late 20s and married, she came from Mayapur, a small town 1.5 hours distance by a suburban train. She was a lively, caring woman who did more than her assigned duty. She would wash Ma's clothes and sometimes cook a special stew for her. Perhaps this was part of her professional grooming. But soon she wormed her way into Ma's enfeebled heart. And this really mattered. Bharati called her Mashima, aunt, and Ma would wait for her to arrive every morning with lucid expectancy. A rare calm would light up her pain-ravaged face when Bharati propped her up against a bolster and combed the few remaining strands of hair on her scalp and talked with her in a voice that one reserves for little girls. Relatives and family friends around town were dropping in to see Ma, to see her off, actually. A few of them were surfacing after ages. One day, I took out my handycam to film such a reunion. But I also wanted to archive Ma's fading moments. Bharati was greatly excited when she saw the fist-sized machine that could capture moving images and sounds in real time and disgorge them on a tiny screen. But I think what attracted her was the camera's complete refusal to differentiate between the memorable and the banal, between a self-conscious face and a doormat, a well-modulated voice and a chair's leg scratching the floor. The fidelity with which it recorded the antics of our pet cat Ganga moved Bharati, and emboldened, she asked me one day, "Can it show me as I am, Dada?" Thus happened the film that I am transcribing here, word for word. I mounted the camera on a stool and turned the LCD screen at her so that Bharati could watch the recording. This, I guess, prodded her on. It was as if she was speaking to a mirror with a memory. I was 5 when we crossed into India. They called me Alpana on that side. My father gave me this name, Bharati, when we got our ration cards. Bharati, because now we were in Bharat. My two uncles had come before us. They were settled. Their children did their schooling here. They married here. A cousin works in Hyderabad in the factory that produces Charminar cigarettes. After we crossed the border, our first stop was at Netaji Nagar. Have you heard of Netaji Nagar? It's on a branch line in Nodia district. Netaji Nagar, Tarok Nagar, Bunkim Nagar, halt stations all. Earlier there weren't any, only endless fields and mango orchards. The stations came up when the refugees moved in and built hutments inside the orchards. In the beginning, the trains didn't stop, but then men would pull the chain to get off. So what could the rail company do? A halt station with a ticket office is good for everyone, Taina. There were snakes in the orchards and floods. I have seen 3 floods at Netaji Nagar. Waist-deep water covered the fields. The party CPIM gave us GR, government relief. We did face floods on the other side, but I have no memory of them. My father pulled a rickshaw there. One day the Mias set fire to it. They threatened to torch our house. So we sold off everything and undertook the crossing. Takes a pause, wipes her face with the end of her sari. I studied till class 4 at the Netaji Nagar Free Primary School. Then the flood hit. It reduced us to a tarpaulin tent on the railway track. I never returned to school. And then we shifted to Notunpolli. It was a new settlement on a sandbar along the Ganga, of the refuse who came before us. At that time, Notunpolli had no school, no road, no pakka building, nothing. Only miles of sand and tall grass everywhere. We built our huts with the grass. The river banks were teeming with jackals and monitor lizards. Once a jackal carried off a baby, a girl. I remember it well. The mother was sunning her in the courtyard. She went inside to warm.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.